We're in the losers bracket. We have eLevate versus Panda Global, a best of three series to determine which one of these two teams will advance. The loser, of course, will drop out and an Abathur ban right away for eLevate on Cursed Hollow. Now, oftentimes, like, we have two heroes that are most of the time in everybody's head. It's Kel'Thas and Tyrande. And if you ban another hero that is also strong on a particular map, then you get access to at least one of them, depending on what your opponent does. So Panda Global, if they don't mind losing Tyrande, but they really want Kel'Thas, they could ban out something like a Zagara, like an ETC, for example, now, and just, like, switch things up here a bit. Normally, you would see a Tyrande ban happening here, but that would give eLevate access to Kel'Thas. Even though I have to admit that we have seen a lot of Zagara plays right now as well. So Zagara oftentimes a first pick. So that Abathur ban, of course, is smart in the sense that he can be very strong with a potential Jaina lineup for the double Jaina copy. He's very good at experience soaking on the map. But this is one of the reasons why he's banned out. And there's the Tyrande. Zagara is the first pick. All right. And now Panda Global can go straight into that Kel'Thas, maybe together with a Mirrodin. Kel'Thas, Mirrodin, or even pick that Jaina away, because Zagara plus Jaina is usually a lot of ouch. So you're trying to get rid of that as well, but they have to make that choice at this point. They could also go into a completely different composition to simply say, okay, we're going to lock down that ETC plus the Uther for the Divine Shield, but they go a very different path. They secure Tassadar, and Kel'Thas. Okay, so that kind of caters towards a potential melee assassin, and we have vision now on the map thanks to a potential mental acuity, but at least the Oracle to take down those creep tumors. eLevate, on the other hand, they can now play a Jaina if they want to and get that extra damage. Jaina Mirrodin would be really solid here, or the ETC. So, that's commitment. Zagara and Sylvanas, okay, that kind of tells us already that they are trying to go and push this in quite heavily. eLevate with the push lineup. Zagara, of course, with the Maw, also great for the Wailing Arrow setup, since you can hit that quite easily on the Maw, and then everybody is going to be silent, so that's a pretty cool move as well. The Panda's Global now with a potential ban here, and would they still be worried about a Jaina, I feel like? Can there still be a Jaina being dropped into this? eLevate with a potential Mirrodin solo, it's definitely an option. So you could ban out Jaina here if you wanted to be on the safe side. And then again, you can also think about a ban on Uther, but I suppose that Panda Global is really thinking about taking the Uther themselves. At least I would. I know I would. I would probably go on the safe side and ban out the Jaina here. Because if they play with a Mirrodin at the frontline as the solo frontliner, then having that Jaina in, I would be more afraid of the Jaina than I would be of the Reyna, to be honest with you. If you go in and you have Zagara, Sylvanas, and a Jaina on top of that, more into silence, into Blizzard, yeah, good night right there. That's going to be a pretty solid kill. The Sonya ban against the Pandas, so okay. That leaves a lot of very good healers up. If they would have banned a healer now, like Uther, for example, it would have allowed Panda Global to take a healer away and just, like, reduce that potential pool of supporters that you can take for eLevate. So they ban out Sonya, which is probably their biggest danger considering the Uther. But Uther ETC are still available, and that of course means you could go into the uninterruptible mosh pit. It's one of the options that they could go for, but if we're talking about, like, frontliners in general, there's Malfurion is taken away from eLevate so that they can't go into the Tranquility against the Kel'Thas bombs. Okay, so they don't go into Uther. Uther is going to be able to get through the draft here if eLevate really want him, and they could definitely take that. They took that, take that chance. Panda Global, still, they need a good frontliner. With a Malfurion, I could even see a Johanna being played here. If you want to have something like really tanky, then Johanna wouldn't really be a bad pick, especially if you can time those bombs, those chain bombs, quite nicely with her. And her condemn, of course, so that you get the targets together. eLevate, a bit late here with the draft. Not quite sure exactly what they picked yet. Panda Global as the frontliner. I suppose they took the frontliner first. But yeah. Oh, our draft is bugging a little bit out here. There we go, Johanna. Okay, that's good. And a Thrall Rhaegar. No Uther. Now, that surprises me. Rhaegar is great, but I feel like that Uther would have given you even a bit more sustain on Thrall. Rhaegar, of course, is amazing because he has a couple of talents that he can throw in as well, like, for example, the Lightning Shield. That's really cool with Thrall. So, yeah, they go for Thrall here at the front line. They had the chance to switch it up and go even more damage on Burst, but it would be, like, you're a bit of a one-trick pony if you go into a Jaina now as well. You really rely on that Wombo combo potential. Panda Global as the last pick on Cursed Holo go into Falstead now, and that, of course, allows them to just simply, like, use that Mighty Gas. We've been talking about it. If you're going for the boss, it's a great tool. And also, if you try to disengage from a Thrall, it can be very nice as well. So game number one is coming up now. eLevate versus Panda Global. Game number one in the best of three series here in loser's bracket of the End of the Storm playoffs in North America. Our first game today on Cursed Holo. Well, it's not the first game on Cursed Holo, but it's the first game between eLevate and the Panda Global team. To the left side of the map, we have eLevate with Nespa on Thrall, Killik on Sylvanas, Bashix on Rhaegar, Hawkfu on Zagara, Boss Floss on Muradin. And once again, Green Jesus in play. And to the right side of the map, we're seeing Big MPCT on Kel'Thas. We have B-Kid on Tassadar. Pandas with Michael Uldal on Falstead. And we have Mr. Barcode himself on Malfurion. Psalm on Johanna to round the lineup up. So, Chain Lightning build for Thrall. Barb Shot not taken. Witherwind instead as the level 1 talent that we are seeing currently on Sylvanas here. So a bit of an adjustment that we have by Team eLevate. And we're still running this with the Zagara at the bot lane. Nespa actually pausing the game. A couple of issues. So, yeah, some lag. But we already have the perfect Storm as the level 1 talent for Muradin. And that, of course, is already very interesting since we have a couple of auto-attack damage dealers on the other side. So they could have gone into the Reverberation build against Falstead here to just limit the damage a bit. But we have, in this case, now perfect Storm to just try to probably combo it off with the Sledgehammer and with the Piercing Bolt and get the extra damage in then later on against like the structures. And talking about the pushing power, this is actually something that they've been doing quite a bit. The entire draft is all about pushing. Zagara and Sylvanas are being played, and that together with the Muradin that apparently goes for the Sledgehammer increased damage, that can really drop a core within seconds. If you get access to the core later on in the game, that can be absolutely brutal. So we have now, besides that, also on the side of the opponent, already a bit of a setup in the mid lane. Of course, with Sylvanas, the whole idea of Team eLevate is to burst one of these towers down right now. That's going to happen because we have Sylvanas, in this case, right now, heading over there as we speak. We have down to the bot lane at the same time, also the updraft taken as the level 1 talent for Falstead. And looking into the mid lane, Knight takes pawn, game has been resumed, and yeah, the tower push at the top is already happening, and the rotation from the mid lane up to the top is also a consequence that immediately is being used. But yeah, there's the tower snipe, or they attempt to do that, and they are going in. They will succeed. The question is, are they going to lose a hero because of it? No, not yet. And Boss jumps out, so yeah, all good in the hood. They get the first tower. That's a bit of experience. Not too fancy just yet, but yeah, that's something that they could already push in. So the rotations are happening up into the mid lane, up to the top. We have still Trilanes going up against each other, so most of the action is going to happen there, at least for the foreseeable future. Unless we have a few rotations going into the middle of the map. Nespa, of course, is getting supported here by Rhaegar. It makes sense to set the two orcs onto the same lane right now. And at the bot lane, we have Hawkfu versus Michael Uldal, trying to, of course, use his Falstead to just, like, zone out Hawkfu a bit and take down a couple of the creep tumors. But it's not going to be an easy lane at all for Falstead, especially because that Hydralisk can, of course, do so much damage and is super annoying. Moonburn as the level 1 talent for Malfurion. And B-Kid and Skelthas, plus, of course, Malfurion, are doing a very solid job at pushing. Oh, Sylvanas. Yeah. That is... Sylvanas is a great hero, and she can really do a whole lot, especially if she's able to just push in with an objective. The problem that you have with Sylvanas is that she doesn't have a lot of hit points. She's like the definition of squishy, so you need to make sure that you somehow escape there. With the wind, talents on level 13 can help with that, thanks to the evasive fire that you get away there. With the wind keeps you at a safe distance, but right now it's just a rotation into the middle real quickly, helping out with the lane push. But of course, both of the teams are now just trying to get to level 4 so that they can fight for the first tribute here in time. And one of the towers is nearly down. Could there be the stun? Muradin is waiting for it. I mean, the more stuns he gets, the more damage, of course, he is going to get on the Stormbolt as well. And if you combo that with a Sledgehammer on level 4, then you can just, like, do so much serious work here. To the bot lane, ho-ho, Falstead, yeah. He needs to be back and then can fly in again, of course. But level 4 talents now for both of the teams, and that will give us another Chain Lightning talent for Thrall. And then follow through. What? Oh, look at that. Okay, that's interesting. Now he goes for Envenom. They have a double Envenom now. That can be nice for the early game, but I'm very surprised that he lets the second Chain Talent go. because if you don't go for that Chain Lightning talent, then you will not have as many abilities that you can spam out to combo off the follow through that is usually the level 7 talent. And yeah, you might see a hybrid build here now. I'm really curious to see what level 7 is going to be for him, because usually the whole idea is to just like spam abilities, have that double charge on the Chain Lightning, and then get those auto attacks in for the extra damage with the follow through on level 7. So this is a bit of an adjustment that could lead into a hybrid build. We have Netherwind taken, also the mental acuity, mainly of course because later on Tassadar is going to take down all of these creep tumors that we have everywhere on the map. Those are going to be very important. Michael is still in lane. He of course moved back and used his fly in to come back into the match. And up at the top lane, it's still that tri lane. We have level 5 now. There's no tribute yet on the map, but that's going to happen soon. The adjustment with Rhaegar not going into the healing talent here, but instead we have the Feral Heart now taken, so that gives him the lane sustain that he needs, and the Sledgehammer, as already expected, has been chosen as the level 4 talent now as well. So with this in play, we're going to see him, of course, trying to just like push that in. And once again, I have to really highlight this. We have a Sylvanas, we have a Zagara, and the Mirrodin with the Sledgehammer build. This is an amazing amount of damage that he can dish out to any kind of structure, and if in the late game they get an opportunity to just like backdoor the core, I can already promise you they are going to take it, because they will drop structures like nothing. It's going to be super fast. We have, besides that, Elune's Grace for the extra range on Malfurion's talents now with on level 4. And Johanna, as the solo tank of the setup, went into the Laws of Hope. First tribute on the map, and it is time to go for it. So both of the teams starting to rotate around. Actually, like Zagara and Forza are still staying at the bottom. Malfurion is moving in. And 3 minutes into the game, we have the bosses now spawning as well. Normal camps on the map spawn 2 minutes in, and of course the bosses spawn at 3 minutes. Yeah, there's the storm, and already Thrall is there too. So they're starting to really just like zone as much as they can for this one. Whoa, B-Kid is actually dropping really low in his Tassadar. He needs to be careful. That could backfire. There's the shield here. And Tassadar, as I said, he needs to be careful. And very much so. But he has still the well up, so he can go for that. Nice Malfurion. Oh, there's the Envenom. Ah, well, if you have two Envenoms against you, that's always a little bit dirty. We already have Zagara moving in after taking this particular lane down. Yeah, going for Johanna. And there's another tribute channel attempt. Good shield clear. But Johanna needs to move away, and that should secure the tribute now finally. We're not quite there yet, especially as Tassadar is starting to move in now. But that could be the kill. Stormbolt and the kill against Malfurion. It's a double kill. Malfurion and Tassadar are both down. Falstead still gets some experience down to the bot lane, but that was a very solid double kill, and therefore, of course, it's going to be an easy level 7 plus tribute, and we are going to have at the top lane the push thanks to Sylvanas. And here's the adjustment, the hybrid build, as already mentioned. We have Rolling Thunder on level 1, and then straight Envenom into Windshear. So, yeah, Thrall being played quite a lot these days, and we have very, very different builds. We have two core builds, one more focus on follow-through and the Chain Lightning, and the other one with a full focus on Wind Fury. And these two core builds can be adjusted occasionally, and that's exactly what we're seeing here. Pressure build as we speak about it. We have in the mid lane a huge amount of pressure now, thanks to Sylvanas, and they are about to drop another one, but Falstead is trying to move in. Thrall gets taken out, got body blocked here by his own mate for a second, and Rhaegar should be able to escape here, or not. Okay, so the dog is down. You put the dog to sleep, and the bot lane pressure now with Sylvanas and Zagara is happening. It's all about the structures at this point. It's really eLevate just like trying to drop these structures as fast as they can. And they do a solid amount of work here. But we have now a second tribute on the map, and so far it looks like they're going to let this go and instead just start pushing at the bot lane. And I guess they should, as long as maybe Mirrodin... can he delay that? I don't think so. Maybe if Thrall was around, he could use a couple of Chain Lightnings to really like drop them back. But yeah. Instead, it's just the bot lane that is being pushed, and thanks to all these structures destroyed, there's of course very, very little that's going to happen in terms of experience leads. You're going to see that early level 10, unless a few heroes are being killed, for Team eLevate. That much is already certain here. Again, there's the potential for a Gravity Lapse, but already too late. Kalthas can't go in for this one and hit it. We have at the top lane still at the same time Malfurion going up against Mirrodin right now. So down to the middle of the map, Psalm is also taking some EXP thanks to the Night Take spawn. Great talent, of course, still for wave clear. I mean, Skeleton Swing and Night Take spawn have been kind of nerfed in the past a bit, but it's still a very solid talent to take. At this point, we still have the additional damage, and we have the Conviction now taken for the increased movement speed now as well. Yeah, down here, the level 10s are going to hit very soon, and now we have another tributor on the map, plus a mercenary camp taken. The heroic abilities with the Sundering. Of course, there's also now the panic button for Rhaegar, going with the Ancestral Healing, Wailing Arrow, and Maul, the deadly combo if you get that silence off after the Maul hits. The early level 10 shouldn't really help them too much. The rotation is also happening towards the tribute, and the level 10s aren't ready yet. But there's the interrupt, and immediately the attack against Johanna. Johanna silenced, but she gets away. B-Kid is moving in now too, though, and he's a bit far out, but he still has the dimensional shift. Boss floss on Mirrodin is moving away as we speak. The Sundering hitting hard, and down goes potentially Kalthus. Yes, they get him just a second before that Ancestral Healing hits. Very well played here. Great kill for them, and that's three kills against two, and a second tribute on the map now as well. So with that, they will be aiming for a curse on the next one. We're seeing at the top lane that, well, the Siege Giants haven't really done too much damage yet, but they are of course forced now the rotation with Falstead to the top lane, and down to the bottom of the map, Zagara can still start to like really take down maybe one of those wells, and also of course deplete the ammunition a bit. Now the rest of the team is rotating in, and look at this, Sylvana super lazy from here to here with the mount. I'm not quite sure if that was really faster, but at least it allowed him to show the Vulture off again. So that's of course sweet as well. So yeah, Vulture shown off, Fort eliminated, and that's already totally worth it. In the mid lane, the tanks are facing each other, the tribute is spawning on the map, and that is tribute number 3. And by the way, Falstead is also aiming for the well. If that well falls, then the position against they could have been in a much better position, I suppose, if they get this well. Nice jump, but they are already on him, and Boss Floss misses the Stormbolt, and down he goes. Yeah, can't fight for that tribute anymore. Unless they really zone for like 22 seconds, which they could do. If you run a Chain Lightning Thrall, and that's Zagara, you could theoretically do this. But I suppose if they are just like going to try and move into the mid and defend first of all this one. Tribute has been taken, it's 2 tributes versus 2 now. And we have at the same time now the push in the mid lane. It's still an experience lead. eLevate is still ahead. eLevate has still a slight lead here. And they are going to try and run with this as much as they can. If they get the early level 13 before the next tribute happens, then they have a very good shot at cursing team like Panda Global. But we have to the top lane. Michael Udall again, he's going to take finally that well down, and that eliminates of course another option of lane sustain for the opponent's team, which is really important since their own well is still there. So these little moves are super important. And in the mid lane we have again also the pressure playlane. Yeah, in terms of damage, we see especially Sylvanas with 20,000 up at the top here. It's a lot of sustain that we are seeing with the double support setup that Panda Global is currently running here. But then again, we have also this pushing power up to the top where one structure after another is being eliminated. And this is like the really big strength that we're seeing on the lineup for Team eLevate. This is really the big strong setup that they have. Just everywhere the opportunity to go straight for a kill against a tower, against a fort, against anything. This tribute at the bot lane, somebody has to start zoning that though. And Falstead is already flying in, they're trying to gather it. Nespa rushes in, gets the Sundering, okay, needs to use his ult to prevent the curse. But now they're dashing in and they're trying to get the kill. And it looks like Psar might fall. Silence! Oh, the triple maw, guys, this is going to be bad. The triple maw is hitting and this is the Stormbolt. Down goes Kalthus, down goes Johanna. This is exactly what they needed, a double kill, and now we have 5 kills versus 3. Healing Surge taking us to level 13 talent, together with a Grace of Air. Curse on the opponent's team, and in a 5 versus 3 situation, they go for boss immediately. Mutalis is going to be the talent on the Zagara, and we have the Evasive Fire as already thought. It could go into the Spell Shield, I suppose, considering that there's a Kalthus, and also like a few other spells like Storm, for example, and Tassadar that you have to deal with at some point. But still, it's a good move to go into the Evasive Fire. Now we have the first boss taken, and they can just simply go up to the top lane and take the second one as well. The opponent's team will have to defend here. We already have Sylvanas, who just like jumped back to the Nexus to get the mana points back. And in the mid lane right now, they are going straight for it. Bot lane has to be defended. This is going to be a lot of structures lost here on the side of the Panda Global team. This is not looking pretty at all. Bot lane, they have to defend this now. They at least took the mercenary camp there, so the Siege Giants are going to help at least a little bit with the defense. Level 13 talents give finally the chain bombs to Kalthus, and that's a big win right there. Hold your ground for Johanna now for the extra iron skin duration, and of course like what 20% that you get from this. Ice block has been chosen, Giant Killer and Prescience on their side, but the wall here is already falling, and this is getting really nasty. The boss is still doing work at the bottom of the map, but of course being defended against as we speak. Even talents but level 15 versus level 13, so a massive lead in experience now for Team eLevate. They're playing a very, very strong play now. They just barely made it into the playoffs, by the way. It was super close. They were tied with two other teams, with Stellar Lotus and... To be honest with you, I don't even know who they were tied with. Was it Cognitive? I don't even remember. But they were tied with two teams, Stellar Lotus and another one. And they only came in because they placed better in individual qualifiers than the opponents. So they do really well here in this first game. And now 5 kills versus 3. We're seeing them just like taking the meta advantage that they have to just get more Siege Giants and also another Bruiser camp in the middle of the map. So the Knight camp is going to push the lane. And we still have, of course, a Golem up at the top. And once that they are in a position where they have level 16, I could definitely see them going for it. The level 16 talent is going to be a very important one for them, because that would allow them to take another boss. They have the vision on the map thanks to Zagara with the creep tumors. She's been very active, especially in the middle of the map up to the top lane. And that level 16 talent is now going to be ready any seconds, and there we have it. And that, of course, is going to give them everything that they need. We have Tempest Fury, Grace of Air, and also the Wind Shear taken. So still 7, 13, and 16. It's more or less a complete Wind Fury build, with the exception that on level 1 it's no Season Marksman. Also not the block that we saw against Nova played earlier, but instead it's the Chain Lightning build. It's a bit of an additional mana sustain that you get out of it. So it's a pretty interesting adjustment here with that Hydra build. Not full damage, no Season Marksman, but still a very solid one. The 16 talent now also, of course, with the Cold Embrace for Sylvanas. And we have the Healing Surge, or the Tidal Waves, my bad, on level 16. So that Bashik gets that cooldown reduction in teamfights if he heals enough. We're also having now the Brute expansion and the Stone Form. But there's no move to capitalize on the level 16 talent. They're not going for the boss, but they are trying to lock Falstad down. Oh, are they? Well, not quite. But they were thinking about it. Level 6... Well, what? Alright. He goes for it, doesn't he? Now, that's... Okay, there's a tribute on the map, and that's why they go for the boss instead. There is a Johanna still. Yeah, if they're unlucky, then this Johanna might fall. Stormbolt has been hit. They move to the top. They try to go for the boss, and they arrive in time. The tribute has been taken, and they go for the boss, but... It's gonna be taken. Can they jump? Sundering? No, it's too late. They get the Sundering and they might get the kills, but the boss has been claimed. Silence as well. Down goes Fort. No, oh my god. The Tranquility is keeping them alive. Falstead moves away in the last second. And now we have the turnaround potential. Level 16 talents for both of the teams. They're still going in, and everybody on the side of Panda Global is extremely low, but nobody dying just yet. Michael moves away now too. There's the jump. And the heal for Kel'Thas, wow, they actually take the boss and are able to escape as well. They have the level 16 talents now, and that means that we have the Erika's for the Tailwind. So yep, that's a pretty sweet talent to take here. It's actually like a talent that's a little bit more common these days once again as well. If you don't go into Hammer Time, then this is usually the choice that we see. Also, Arcane Barrier has now been chosen. Arcane Barrier as the next talent here. We have another tribute on the map that they could take now too. And considering the bot lane, there's a bit of a push happening. We have now Tenacious Roots taken, there's the Imposing Presence and Dimensional Warp. But this is still another tribute that the red team could fight over. Now, already Thrall. Oh, Falstad getting away there. Once again, they start to go in, and the Mighty Gust is pushing them away. Actually, these Chain Bombs did a lot of damage because of it. It was a nice spread because everybody got Mighty Gusted into the same position. But Falstad is still down, and this is now another tribute, and therefore two tributes for those teams. Yeah, they go in again and try to steal, actually, or try to first of all take Kel'Thas down, but Nespa doesn't have his heroic ability ready. He was actually trying, he used it during the fight there, but yeah, well, he was still able to escape. So it's 17 versus 16 right now in level, 6 kills against 3. So in team fights, we definitely see eLevate with a slight advantage. But we don't have a single keep eliminated yet. There's still 2 forts on the map, so in terms of like main structures, we have 5 against 3. The boss is up. I would be a bit careful about this, to be honest. This is going to be a huge risk that they're running here, because Falstad can fly in, and he has Mighty Gust up, so he can try to steal their camp away. Uh-oh, I'm not... Yeah, they leash it, and they let it go. All right, they have to. That was a huge risk, and I agree with that retreat. I don't really think that they had what it takes there. They probably thought that they had an opportunity to take it and then realized midway that it's not going to happen. Tributor is also spawning right now, and whoever wins this fight can go for Curse plus also Boss. So this is going to be a crucial one right now. It's going to be a super important fight. It could be a fight that really determines who takes the first keep in the game. And we already have both of them just like spamming out their spells as much as they can. Nice lockdown, but Boss Plus immediately with the Avatar can go in, and Tranquility has been used. They can move away now, wait it out a bit. Everybody's going to be on full health again, but still looking strong. Killik may be a little bit low in mana here on his Sylvanas, but they are about to move in again, and now that Tranquility is out of the question, this is going to be strong. There comes the Mighty Gust again. Triple more, and that stun on Boss Force is going to hit, and it's hitting hard. No, it's one, and already Malfurion isolated. Force Wall is where... Oh. I have no idea what Malfurion did to B-Kid, but that was definitely... that was him definitely sealing the death of Malfurion. So, yeah, that didn't work against them. I was just about to say, that was a beautiful Force Wall isolating Malfurion, and then I realized that Malfurion and Tesla are on the same team, and I'm just like, well, maybe he insulted his mother earlier or something like that. I don't know exactly what was going on there, but either he really just misclicked hard, or he just thought like, all right, you're dead anyways, time to secure that. No, that was of course a bit unfortunate. Malfurion wouldn't have gotten away anyways. Like, you can't place that force. Like, with the position that the other heroes had, I don't really think that there was an option to go for a force wall that would really save Malfurion. I don't think that could potentially happen. But now, of course, this is that disastrous position that I've been talking about. You are cursed. You have the boss moving against you. There's even Siege Giants taken. If this is not a keep, then I don't know what will be. Level, well, we have the same talents, but still, it's 5 versus 5. But this situation is just absolutely, this is brutal. This is everything that you can possibly like hope for. That keep is gonna fall. There's no way. They need even to be careful, because if they lose a team fight now and lose a few heroes, just 2 would be enough. Then that would mean that they can go for core. But I don't think that's gonna happen. So they're gonna be probably happy to just like get the keep and then rotate away. But they're gonna wait and see if they can maybe get a kill there. Oh, more against Malfurion. That could be the kill. And already the Stormbolt and goodbye. Guys, this could be game. This could be game right now. They already go for Johanna. This is game, or is it? Well, maybe not quite. Yes, false that down. Siege Giants and Boss on core. This is it. GG is called, and we are going to see the next game with a lead for Team eLevate after this first match here on Cursed Hollow. Great play by eLevate, and they take the lead in the best of 3 series. Our second game is going to be on Dragonshire. We have eLevate versus Panda Global, and eLevate is ahead with a 1-0 in this series now. Zakara immediately being banned by Panda Global. So, yeah, Dragonshire, of course, a great map for Zakara. You get usually access to at least one of the shrines if you play her, and that's something that they want to shut down right from the get-go. eLevate now with a potential ban on Tyrande, since she is oftentimes still being banned out because, well, your opponent, if you go into a Tyrande, can always try to go for one of these sniper comps, and she is just so powerful. We've seen her actually played a couple of times here today already, but most of the teams still go for the option to ban her out. If they don't want to do that, then eLevate could play in something like an ETC, an Uther, just go for like a different ban. The two heroes that are... it's actually shaking up a little bit. For the longest time, it was like really that Kel'Thas and Tyrande that was being picked early, but now we have also Zagara in that mix, so it's suddenly 3 heroes that you're trying to fight over, and that changes things a bit. If it's only 2, then you can always go for like 2 tier 2 hero bans, or like not the top bans, and then each team gets one of them. Panda Global, for example, could lock down that Kel'Thas now, and eLevate would respond most likely with maybe even a Jaina on their side. But the Pandas are waiting. Mirrodin has been a very early pick as well. We're talking Dragonshire here, so there's nothing really that stands out too much. Mirrodin can be very strong, Kel'Thas can be a very strong early pick, and I'm a little bit curious to see what the Pandas are going to do. They go Jaina over Kel'Thas. They take Jaina over Kel'Thas, and of course the reaction is immediate. Mirrodin probably together with Kel'Thas here. No, again, eLevate with the Sylvanas. They really, really love their Sylvanas, and of course, we've been going over this a lot. If you play on a map where, like, Dragonshire, Infernal Shrines, Haunted Mines, any map where you have like either a summon or something that you can control and push in, having that Sylvanas is extremely powerful since you are in a position where you can just disable all of the structures. The problem that you run into is that the Pandas Global have now the Jaina plus Mirrodin, and that means Stormbolt into Blizzard, which can do a lot of damage and is part of a sniper composition that usually Tirana belongs to, but of course in this case isn't really working out. As Sonya is even using more burst damage, the Pandas are really going all out now with the damage. They really want to make sure that they have a very strong setup here at the front, and that can, this can hurt. This can hurt a lot what they're currently running there. So eLevate, they need to be careful. Ban an Uther is a solid ban if you don't want to take him yourself. And I actually kind of expected them to take Uther, but they decided to ban him instead, and the Pandas, I'm a little bit curious to see what they're going to ban out right now, because at this point, I'm not really sure what eLevate is going to do in terms of their own picks here. I would probably welcome, okay, Tassadar is being banned, I like that, that's good, that's pretty solid, like it's a generic ban more or less. eLevate could go into a Johanna here at the front line, I would probably like that quite a bit, considering that the rest of the tanks that they could use will probably have quite a few problems against the setup that the Pandas are running right now. Next question that of course arises is, are you going to go into a Tyrael and play some kind of like double warrior composition, or are you really running this entire setup with only one? There could be again a melee assassin, and they played Rhaegar together with Thrall the last time, so they did let Uther go in the last game as well, so no Divine Shield for that Thrall, so they could try and play something along the same lines now at two, which wouldn't be too bad. Johanna, as I said, I like that choice, I really like it, would have been my choice as well for the frontliner. And now the question, do you run... They probably pick their healer now. If they want to get Thrall, the chances that Panda Global, after picking Sonya, is taking Thrall as well are, like, slim to none, I'd say. So if I would go for a gamble, I would put my, I would use my healer now, and they agree. They take Rhaegar, so Thrall is a very, very likely pick on the last one. Panda Global, I wonder if they are thinking about taking it away. I really wonder if they are thinking about this now. Like, imagine a setup where they pick Thrall and Karazim now. Sonya, Thrall, Mirrodin, Karazim at the front line, Jaina in the back. That would be... It would be kind of fun to see, to be honest with you. And then Sundering into Leap. Screw Wrath of the Berserker. We're gonna go all Leap. Haymaker on top of that. Because why not? Let's YOLO. but yeah, Pandas Global, I mean, right now, they can go for additional... And I suppose that it's going to be... It could be a Malfurion. They could run Malfurion, yes, there is, for the lockdown, Mirrodin, Root, Stormbolt, everything in there. And for the last pick, personally, I would probably use that for that, and I think that would be a very smart choice here. Gives them a bit more damage. There is also Reyna to consider as well, of course. The zoning abilities of him with any kind of like Hyperion that he can use are great. Single target damage, if you want a bit more, thanks to the Reyna's Raiders, are also an option for you. But zoning is strong. Vala, again, also a solid pick. Has a bit more wave clear than Reyna has, and that's always nice on Dragonshire, since the more access you get, it is the Thrall as the last pick. I mean, it was a given. After that, Rhaegar already taken, and with the way the last game went, that was to be expected. So yeah, eLevate with a very similar build to what they had in the last game. Not quite the same thing, but like the basic idea behind it is very similar. Melee Assassin plus Rhaegar having that one frontliner. And guys, we're going to find out if they take the 2-0 or if the Panda Globals are able to fight back in this one and force it into a map 3. So we're going to jump into Dragonshire and going to check out together who's going to win game number 2. Second game has started, and eLevate to the left side once again. They currently are in the lead in the best of three here. We are in loser's bracket of the End of the Storm playoffs North America, and that of course means the team that loses is out of the tournament. Nespa is playing Thrall. We have Killik on Kalthas, Bashix on Rhaegar, Hakfu on Sylvanas, and Bossfloss for eLevate currently on Johanna. To the right side of the map, Biggie on Jaina, B-Kid on Vala. We have Michael on Sonya, Psalm on Mirrodin, and Mr. Barcode himself is playing Malfurion. Again, a bit of a different build for Thrall. This time, with all those auto attack damage dealers, we have him with Block as the level 1 talent. We have Still with the Wind taken on Sylvanas. It's kind of fun to really see like this barbed shot with the wind style that we have here. Shot of Fury taken on the side of... up to the top, the pressure play. Yo, there we go. But going up against a Sylvanas usually means that you're going to lose that first tower. There's the rotation there for happening. Multi-shot build on Vala, and we see Jaina straight with that level 1 Conjurer's Pursuit. So the fight is already about to happen here. And yeah, Hakfu jumps away with that Haunting Wave. And okay, so for now, really, lanes are just going to be taken. Nespa up at the top lane versus Michael. Oh, nice spear. That was a good one. Well done, Ron. Good and well, nice anticipated. This was really, it's one of those things that you ever use now and then, just like throw in, try to go for a bit of a prediction, hook, prediction, spear, depending on what kind of hero you play. And at this point, it really worked out for them. So, of course, everybody is just like still running around, trying to get the rotation in between the mid lane and the top lane. They're trying to go for Rega. That Stormbolt looked like he was a bit delayed, like mid lag or something. Either way, like, it's not going to work out, and therefore we have the shrines activating with still all of the teams having their five heroes on the map. And as I say, Johanna is under a bit of trouble or pressure, but still can get away. Psalm, on the other hand, might not be so lucky. He just barely hops out of there. B-Kid also pressuring it in. Top lane was taken by Thrall. He has pretty nice sustain there. So does Sonya, of course. But this is going to be a very interesting battle between the two of them up at the top lane here. Down to the bottom of the map, we are seeing, of course, also quite a bit of a fight for that second shrine. And it looks like this time it's going to be eLevate who secures it. That would put both of the shrines into their hands. But Sonya is already busy up at the top trying to make sure that she gets at least one for her team. She's kind of low right now. So Nespa could really, with that extra sustain that he has, start to go in and take this one. Fight at the bot lane is also still ongoing. And nice, there we have the approach to maybe get one of those Dragon Knights. Not quite. Rotation to the shrine is happening as we speak, and Jaina is just like sitting in the bush waiting for a potential Ice Lance to throw in so that she can zone this out long enough until that bottom shrine has been taken. And Boss Floss on his Johanna is down. But at the top lane, it's the kill against Sonya at the same time. Sonya down, and well, it's a kill for a kill right now. So still pretty sweet. Envenom has been taken on two of the heroes again, so that double Envenom on Sylvanas and also Thrall is still being played here. We have Hawkfu jumping away once again, just like making sure that he's escaping, and of course can't wait too long because that was a lot of damage that was already coming in. We have now with the level 4 talents also Elune's Grace for the extra range on Malfurion. It's going to help him to also just like throw down that Moonburn and make sure that he is just like cancelling all the channels, especially in the middle of the map. Netherwind is a level 4 talent. We have Nespa up at the top lane starting to move away again. A slightly inexperienced for the team in blue. Nothing like too fancy yet. Laws of Hope on Johanna for a bit of extra sustain that we are seeing now as well. And it's still a pretty solid move, especially in the mid lane, as suddenly Vala is in a bit of trouble. But of course, with a quick vault, she is able to move out there. Sonya at the top, assisted by Mirrodin, so there's very little chance for Thrall to actually go in for this one, but the bot lane shrine, this is a different matter. It's pretty cool to see that both of the teams are actually focusing heavily on the shrine control, but Thrall is in trouble up at the top, and he could actually fall here. Malfurion falls first at the bot lane, but Thrall is still not out of the woods yet, and it is the counter kill. Kaboom! He gets thrown halfway through the map. Vala also suffering quite a bit of damage, but she is surviving. Will have to move away here, though. Oh, flames. Oh, that could have hit. And so it's two kills versus two kills. Both of the teams very, very eager to get the first Dragonite here. Nobody really succeeding yet. The earlier level 7 here on the side of eLevate, but nothing too fancy happening because that time window is just a bit too small. Windshear taken. We have now the unstable poison and the battle momentum. But up at the top lane, we have, again, Hawkfu starting to zone this back. Thrall is going to go for the shrine. At the bot lane, on the other hand, yes, they're going to get the kill against Jaina. Great play here. eLevate with another good kill, but they might lose Kel'Thas because of it. Kel'Thas, yeah, he's getting jumped and murdered. And if a dwarf jumps straight on your head, then you know that you are in a bit of trouble. An attempt by Hawkfu to go for the Dragon Eye, but already the shrine cancelled out. And now we have that fight at the top lane again, where it seems like Sonya is not going to make that here. Are we going to have the chain lightning? No! Is he gonna fall? Michael survives. Oh my god, that was crazy. Just barely getting away there, and I guess Thrall was pretty salty that he didn't have his chain lightning cooldown up, or he would have used that immediately to drop him. Well, as is, we have the bot lane jump here again, and Malfurion is also, of course, doing his job here, healing everybody out. But I love how both of the teams are very, very eager to just now get that first Dragonite and really fight for every single inch of the map. We have to the top lane again, Thrall in position, this time against Jaina actually. And another rotation is happening with Hawkfu and Killik. They could try to go, well, they will. First of all, they're going to take that shrine, and they already rotate into the middle. This could be a very nice attempt now. Malfurion, dude, like, I'm not quite sure what you are doing. Okay, he's waiting for reinforcements, and that's going to work much better. But Dragonite could still be captured, depending. Yeah, they're gonna get, no, they're not! Oh, Johanna moved away. I actually thought that Boss Boss would sacrifice himself to stay on the shrine a little bit longer and allow them to get the Dragonite, but he moved away and actually escaped thanks to the Iron Skin. That's a nice attempt, but the wall is falling and there's still a few too many heroes here. The rotation, on the other hand, is happening from Panda Global and they are starting to really put pressure onto this mid lane, which allows again Johanna at the bot lane to go up against Malfurion. That's a bit of a battle. In the middle, on the other hand, Nespa and Hanfu are still doing their thing. Vala is dead, just got eliminated here in the back, and that's the early level 10, and it could be the Dragonite right now, as Malfurion is still trying to control the bot lane. There it is, Sundering, Wailing Arrow failed, but still the kill against Malfurion, and that's all that they need. So yeah, the Sundering and Wailing Arrow combo that they went for now, that didn't really work out the way that it was intended. A bit of a lacking communication that we just saw there. But still, they got the kills and now they can just simply push in the lane. Ideally, they would have taken, of course, both of the shrines and captured the Dragonite. But right now, as long as they can really put the pressure on the lane itself, it's not going to make a big difference. Either way, they're going to get their kills in against the structures. And now we have also Bashiqs and his Rhaegar starting to move in. A lot of pressure already against the fort. Kalthas is up at the top, and we're having now with level 10s all the water elemental strafe. We have Wrath of the Berserker, Avatar, and Tranquility in play as well. There's again the move at the bot lane, where Johanna is attempting to hold this for a bit longer. Psalm is missing the Storm Bolt, but with the Iron Skin, she should be able to get away there. It's going to be close, though. The body blocks are definitely real, but yes, nice move there. And Sonya is, in the meantime, dying at the top, as is Vala. So action everywhere on the map right now. And a really great game of Team eLevate already. I mean, they are really making some headway here, especially with Hakfu always present to push lanes in even further. So now they go through the entire wall at the top. They take down both of the towers. They are in position to just like take all of this. And of course, Boss Boss at the bottom lane is still not only soaking experience, but also threatening to take that second shrine if there's a too big rotation happening. And I mean, you can already tell that right now up at the top, this is going to be another fort. And with this one dying, guys, we could see an early level 13 here for them, and then maybe that first Dragonite. I mean, we're 8 minutes into the game and no Dragonite yet, and it feels more and more like we're going to see a massive pressure play at the bot lane instead. Boss Floss against Malfurion. That's going to work for a bit longer, but the rotation is already ongoing, and now Iron Skin has been used already. Yes, no. There's no Storm Ball, at least not in time. So yeah, level 13 any second, but Johanna needs help. And they have level 13 now, they dropped the fort, healing surge on Rhaegar already. And of course, after the level 7 talent, we're also seeing the level 13 focusing on Windfury with the Grace of Air. 16 is going to do the same thing, but especially those chain bombs on Kalthas are going to start to make a lot of work happening. Nice adjustment also with Sylvanas. Sylvanas heading straight into that spell shield, not going into the evasive fire, which we oftentimes see. Against that potential play with especially, of course, Jaina, they don't want to make this work. Of course, again, B-Kit making sure that there's no Dragonite for the blue team, cancelling out the shrine at the top, and we are now 9 minutes into the game and we don't have a Dragonite yet. Even those level 13 talents did not really make a difference here. Push in the bot lane to drop not only the fort, but maybe even go for the tower here. We have now a 2-level lead already for the team in blue, and they are playing a very solid game here. I really have to commend them for the effort that they put in here right now. The experience soak on these guys is absolutely insane, thanks to all the structures that they take down. This Sylvanas play that they're showcasing now is absolutely excellent. Bottom lane, Hakfu is starting to move away. There's no one that can really do anything about this, but this is going to be Dragonite. It should be. Yep, shrine is taken. If someone rotates over to the statue, it should be the first Dragonite in the game. Nespa is moving in. Of course, they have to face the music here now. But, well, they might not get it after all. Now we have more, Rhaegar's moving in, but bot lane is being captured. Jaina is down, though. Hakfu able to take her down. But at this point, we have also Sonya. Oh, Sonya is about to fall. Hakfu gets away. Sonya actually alive still. Oh my god, no way. Really? That Malfurion Tranquility. Can't believe that he stayed alive. Mystical Spear, definitely one of the key talents that helped that. But we have now finally the Dragonite taken. Muradin is too late. Muradin at the top lane is too late. Dragonite is taken. 13 versus 13 talents with a Frost Shot, Mystical Spear, Thunder Strike, Ice Block, and Improved Ice Block have been taken here. And this is going to be an early level 16 talent potentially. Of course, again, Sylvanas is straight with the team in position to go for this one. Akfu needs to be careful where he goes though. We have Bashik's already in a position where he can at least heal his ally. But this is, of course, the kill. Oh, Akfu! Ancestral healing, not needed yet, but it's getting closer. They could go for a kill against Psalm if they use the stun. Nah, not yet. Thrall is, of course, in the Dragonite, or he would have used the Thundering right there to lock it down. But the level 13 talent, 16 talents, this is going to be the important one now with the Tidal Wave. So, of course, great talent to have in these scenarios. Arcane Barrier as well, even the Cold Embrace. And they are really, really pressuring the Panda Globals now. These boys have, I mean, they could go for Keep right now. Three talent lead, the Dragonite on the map for another 8 seconds. Get some damage in here and get that Sylvanas going. Hell yeah, you can do some damage against that Keep. You can take that down if you want, especially with a lot of these heroes already on half HP. Here comes the immediate move straight for Sylvanas. Thundering being used. They go in against Jaina and the kill. Yes, Jaina down. Malfurion about to die. Hakfu still alive, but for how much longer? It's a double kill that we see here. And it's more than that. It's a triple kill as Sonya falls. They lose Thrall, but they take down everybody else. It's a full team wipe, and this is going to be Keep. Easy Keep at that. They go straight for it. And can they go core? They're really low. Mana on Bashix is still there. They try to go for the core. That could actually work out. But as I said, they are low, but it doesn't really matter, I feel. With 10 seconds on Jaina, who's going to stop them? This should be the 2-0 victory now for Team eLevate against Panda Global. Ancestral healing. Yes, that's going to be good. The GG is called as finally Jaina comes into play, but this is already too late. And it is game over, a 2-0 victory for eLevate against Panda Global, and they advance now to face Galeforce Esports in the next round of the Losers Bracket. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is GG and the end of another series here on Khaldor TV with Heroes of the Storm. So once again, we have another video finished, and I hope that you enjoyed the commentary and that you liked the game, of course, as well. It was a pleasure casting the match for you. And if you guys really enjoyed it, then make sure that you give that video a thumbs up on YouTube. And of course, if you haven't subscribed to the channel yet, feel free to do that too. If you have friends that are interested in Heroes of the Sports esports scene, then definitely recommend the channel to them or just show them the video if they want to see like a bit how the pros are drafting here, especially, of course, when it comes to the North American scene, European scene. And I mean, these days we even have a couple of Chinese games on the channel here, so I hope that you enjoy that as well. That being said, thank you very much for watching again. I'm going to see you guys next time with more Heroes of the Storm content here on the channel. Have a great day and enjoy your week, and see you soon. Bye bye.